Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. Yes, I'm actually doing an introduction, just myself for once. Just to give you a quick heads up of the episode to come with Craig Berry. I'm very excited about this episode. There's going to be a lot of great chat about it. I just wanted to do a quick message also just to thank you. As of today, this is the 13th of August. We've had over 900 listens and views across all episodes, across YouTube, across Facebook, and through various podcast places like iTunes, everywhere, iTunes, Spotify, just anywhere you could probably get a podcast, it'll be there. I just want to really thank you for listening, thank you for embracing the SWN podcast, and I hope we'll get more episodes soon. I've already got four more interviews to come in the next 4 weeks or so, and then I can open up. Once I get to about 2-3 left, I'll open up the month and we'll get into September. But I'm really excited for what's to come, and hopefully you'll just continue on this journey with me. That being said, if there's any sponsors out there want to sponsor an episode and want to be included, want to have their message read out in this portion of the podcast, and then please contact me, scottresnett@gmail.com. You can also tweet us or Facebook us at Scott Resnett as well. I am the sole runner of the Twitter page, so it'll be me that you speak to. Same Facebook, it'll be myself or Adam usually. But if you get in touch with me, we'll discuss it. Really want to get more people's eyes on this. I want to get your product out there as well. Why not? We've got the SWN podcast. We as well make it great for everyone. And I really hope that you enjoy the episode that's coming up. So again, thank you for watching and enjoy. Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, Billy. As you know, this is my face if you're watching on the video. I am joined this week by the Crimson Cobra from the Fife Pro Wrestling Asylum, Craig Berry. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
So we're going to just do the boring question because that's what's expected of this podcast. How did you get into wrestling?
Wrestling, I got into that, I think kind of like anyone else does. I ended up stumbling upon it on TV one time, and I just really liked what I saw. I thought, this is incredible. And then years later, I kind of just thought, I could probably do that. Turns out I couldn't, it just wasn't fit. And then a few more years later, I decided, well, let's try it again. And I've stuck at it since. And yeah, it's been a joy. I quite enjoy it.
So where did you start off?
I don't know how else to say that.
Yeah, where did you start off?
It started off at W3L over when they were based in England office originally. Then they moved to Kirkcaldy. I'm actually not sure where they're based now because I stopped keeping up with wrestling for a few years, especially around the independent scene. But when I was still in high school, I was desperate to try and do an activity, and I remembered wrestling, so I tried to look for a wrestling school, and W3L was really the only one in Fife at the time. So I went along there. I met Mike, met a few other guys that were there as well. And yeah, started that way. I left just because I wasn't fit. I couldn't keep up. And high school was being a bit stressful as well at the time. Went to college, went to uni, got my degree. And then I seen FPWA was starting up, and I thought, you know what, let's try it again. And I've stuck with it since, because I feel like I was in a much better position.
Excellent. So they opened, what was it, September last year? August, September? So were you the first batch?
Yeah, around about September time. Yeah, I was one of the first ones there, one of the FPWA originals, as I'm going to call everybody. I want to start getting everybody to call each other that, but it's not really calling it, but oh well.
So I think if I mind right, when I was doing my research, because I did some research, you had an injury before you started actual wrestling, is that right? It was your knee?
Yeah, it was my knee. So there's this thing called Ultra MMA, to around not just Scotland, but all entire UK. They do it's like charity fights that they do to raise money for Cancer Research UK. And I seen that they were going to be in Glenrothes. Well, they were going to be hosting an event at the Dunfermline Pavilion, but and they were doing the training in Glenrothes. So me being me, saying, you know what, that looks fun. I could probably do that. Signed up for it. In the second week of training, I ended up, I'm not even entirely sure what I actually did. I remember just doing the exercises and twisting, and my knee, well, my leg twisted, but my knee kind of stayed in place, if that makes sense. So, right. Like, I was pivoting. Yeah, it's not nice. and eventually, I found out that I ended up dislocating my kneecap, chipping part of the bone just below the kneecap off. That was fun. That put me out. Well, that happened, and I want to say, that was probably around about March time last year, so March 2019, and I had my surgery in about April 2019, and then I was at FPWA for September, which doctors told me not to do. So
that was my first thought when you said that. I was like, that's what 3 months, three, four? I can't do maths. 5 months. So 5 months from surgery, and you're I'm assuming running ropes and doing a lot of strength things, which would take a lot out of your knees. So what was it like? I mean, you did it with W3L for a little bit. What was it like getting back into the ring after having such a major knee surgery?
Scary. Was really scary because I actually thought about not doing it. At first, I thought to myself, "No, this is. I'm probably going to put myself back to square one. I'm going to be in much worse shape than I was before." And yeah, just really scary. Once I actually got into it though, and realised, okay, my knees might be a little bit more stronger than I thought it was, because I was doing physiotherapy and I was doing rehab on it. I was going to the gym, just trying to strengthen it on my own while actually going to the physiotherapy that the hospital was providing. Once I got in there and started running the ropes, it was, touch and go, I'd say, for a little bit. Like, some days I'd be, okay, I'm actually fine. The other days I'd be, oh, my knee's feeling a bit funny today, actually, let's take it easy. But after the first couple of sessions, I'd say it was fairly good. I still get a little bit of a, jip every now and again, but I think that it's more now more than ever, just because I'm not able to go to a gym and keep, working out as much as I possibly can. The only type of exercise I get now is whenever I'm walking to Asda, per se.
So I guess that's everyone's pretty much exercise routine. Well, mine's walking a dog. That's pretty much all I do for exercise. But in fairness, when there was everything open, that was my only exercise anyway. I have an aversion to keeping fit. I prefer eating and not keeping fit.
Me too, man, honestly.
I mean, you've got a motivation now to get wrestling. I saw before we started off this first tangent of the show. There's a PlayStation controller in the background, so
yeah.
Because I've got no other segue that I can think of in my mind. What are you playing just now?
So I'm playing Fall Guys right now. That just came out. That's absolutely amazing. It's taken over my life, and that not all I'm playing, to be honest. It is just one of those games that just came out with the PlayStation Plus subscription, so that's such a fun game. It's really is how they're describing it as is it Takeshi's Castle? I never pronounced that right. Takeshi's Castle. Total Wipeout, and it's really fun. The other two games I'm really playing right now is a game called Divinity Original Sin 2. I'm not sure if anyone's really heard it. It's quite a good game. It's quite similar to Dungeons and Dragons and all that, but video game style, turn-based combat, lots of cool characters and a lot of great lore in this world that they've built up from, it's bad, I actually don't remember the names, but name of the studio, but it's a really good game. You should check it out. The first one's good as well. And the other game I'm currently playing is Persona 5 The Royal, because I really enjoyed the first one. And this remade version is just brilliant.
I keep getting told, because I got a PS Vita last year for my birthday. Well, I bought it myself, but it was for my birthday. And the first time I put it out, like going, I've got a Vita, give me some recommendations in Persona 4, maybe 5, yeah. I don't know. Never played
Persona
that
4 Golden? Yeah.
That'll be it, yeah. Not, I've never heard of these games, but I've heard great reputation about them.
They're brilliant. It's like, if you're wanting to start off with like a good JRPG, then Persona is the way to go. I would always say Persona 5, because that was the first one I started with. But, you know, it's whatever you get hands on, really. Persona is the way to go, though. Or Shin Megami Tensei as well. That's pretty decent.
Yeah, I think my gaming prowess right now is just Lego games. It's my just relax, chill out. I got a Lego Jurassic World for the Vita, so when I should be working, I'm usually just playing Lego. Hopefully no one work actually listens to this, because that could be awkward. Right, let's swing back. We'll come back to things like Dungeons & Dragons later on, because that'll be the thing I want to learn about. But we'll swing back to the wrestling just for a moment, just so we can at least get the wrestling part of SWN ticked off.
Yeah.
So you started watching, again, from my research, about 2005. And your characters that you really enjoy were like The Undertaker, Rey Mysterio, check me. Right, so is there any other favourites that you had growing up, or any that you went back to watch and found to be amazing?
Apart from like really Rey Mysterio and Undertaker, I quite liked Edge. Just, I don't know, just something about him, just really charismatic, really evil. I was a really weird kid. I just really liked evil stuff. Like, I used to watch a lot of horrors when I was younger, when I really shouldn't have been watching them. And not saying that, you know, Edge is a horror kind of gimmick or anything like that, but it was just evil and how that feed with Matt Hardy that he had over, like, a real life kind of situation as well was, I don't know, just really good and made me like Edge for some weird reason when I really, really shouldn't have liked him. Apart from that, really, like Chris Jericho's always a favourite as well. He's still one of the best, if not the best, back then as well. I'm not really sure. It's kind of hard to remember, but yeah, I would say the all-time great for me though was probably Undertaker back then. It's just, as I said, I was a weird kid.
Yeah, 2005. So yeah, I was more Matt Hardy's side because I was a humongous Hardy Boys fan. So it was just always the way. But Edge is just, that was the kind of end of 2004, I think it was Royal Rumble 2004. Then upwards, that was kind of his ascent, wasn't it, into the world title picture, and eventually winning it the year after in 2006. I've just said that wrong. It was Royal Rumble 2005 before anyone corrects me. That was when the ascent started for Edge. So from there, you've got those as your favourites. Nowadays, is there anyone that you'd add to that list? I mean, Edge is kind of active nowadays. He's injured just now, but Rey Mysterio is still going. Undertaker is apparently retired. So and Jericho is still kicking about. So who's your favourites right now, whether it's WWE, AEW, UK Indies, whatever?
So favourites right now, obviously I answered this beforehand on like one of the interviews I've done for SWN before. It has slightly changed again, just because, well, with the content that, you know, all companies are putting out right now in the current situation, there are somehow new stars shining. Chris Jericho is still always going to be up there, one of the all-time greats, so he's still one of my favourites just because he is quite, well, flexible when it comes to like pretty much anything he does. Just trying to think off the top of my head there, like Tommaso Ciampa, I still love everything he does, not seen too much more. No, not really much more actually, apart from that, really. Then I love MJF, he's absolutely fantastic. even though he's like, you know, I don't know what too far is these days when it comes to living your gimmick, but he does it really well and people still buy his match, so can't be that too bad, can he?
Yeah, that's the thing. I think I can't get on board with the MGF because of that. I like having, like, when I watch the bad guys and all that, like your Alexa Bliss and all that, like, they're really mean and that in the ring and all that, but you just get the peek behind the curtain slightly and they're just nice. And I like that when I know that they're characters. But with MGF, it's like, I can't differentiate you between that. And I don't know why. I think, I mean, back when I was younger, that would have been amazing. But nowadays, I just like to know that they're not horrible in real life, you know?
No.
Especially nowadays, with all the evidence come out, I like to know that the people that I'm watching that aren't backstage just being exactly the same as they are on front camera. But I could be wishful thinking a lot of the time.
Definitely.
I'm going to throw out one of these questions that we've got, because we've got quite a few of them, and we're going to start with Stephen Brown's, because he's put out the nice ones. And they're about wrestling, pretty much. He's put out wrestling ones, and then we kind of move on. Stephen Brown, at Stephen Brown 456 on Twitter, he would like to know, what's your motivation for wrestling and what your future goals are?
Okay, so motivation. This might sound selfish, but it's for self-improvement, really. Motivation for that is, I broke my knee trying to do something that I thought I could do, and I didn't. I just couldn't. And now I've kind of came back from it, and I want to try and prove to myself that, okay, that last time was a fluke. It's a totally different sport, it is, but it's still physically demanding. Maybe, I don't know which one is more physically demanding, because you'll hear arguments from both sides, I'm sure. But the motivation there is just to prove to myself that, you know, you could do this. This could be something you could do. You could make this a full-time job. You can make this a career. That's pretty much the motivation there. And there was a second part to that, wasn't there? What was the second part?
Your future goals, which I think future you're kind goals. Of covering a little bit with the motivation bit. But
yeah,
I want to get there.
Yeah, I want to make this a full-time job. I do want to make this not just a hobby, which I think a lot of people do when they come into the industry. And I'm not, like, saying that shouldn't be, you know, your mindset going into it, because that's fine. Like, you do what you want to do. It's your life. You do whatever you need to do. But for me, I do want to make this a full-time gig. I want to make this my career. I would love to work for pretty much any of the big companies right now. I'd love to work for AEW. I love what they're doing. I like how it's almost cool to, like, kind of be like an AEW fan, because it is the rebellion against, almost like the rebellion, like the revolution, as Cody puts it. But on the same side, I would, you know, I think it's everyone's dream once in a while, like, I'd be WWE champion. I once had a dream of saying, I'm going to be the first Scottish WWE champion ever, and then Drew McIntyre goes away, or Drew Galloway goes away and ruins that for me. Like, I would love to, like, work for WWE, AEW, New Japan Pro Wrestling, and the indies here. I really want to do, and this might just be because I'm biased right now, but I would love, and I know it's probably going to happen, it might not, I'm saying that, I might jinx myself, I'd love to do an FPWA show. We were meant to do one, and was meant to be the first student showcase. That was meant to happen in May, and then obviously what's currently happening in the world kind of stopped that, which was sad. But yeah, other than that, goals wise I'd love to work for TNT wrestling as well.
Cool.
That's pretty much covering it.
Yeah, when you're speaking about the different sports, I'm not one that's watched that much MMA outside of just like maybe the odd Brock Lesnar fight when he was going, and the 30 seconds of CM Punk, but there's a big difference. It's the MMA thing, it's more physical, you're not playing to a crowd, and then the wrestling, you've got to do the moves, make sure you don't hurt anyone for real, play with the crowd, get the crowd on your side or against you, whatever, and then you've got to put it all together for whatever 15 minutes from as soon as you come out the curtain and as soon as you exit again. So for, I mean, in my mind, I would say it's more, not just physically demanding, but mentally demanding, because anytime I think of, for any moment that I think I'm going to be a wrestler, or if I look myself in the mirror and think, yeah, that's a physique of a wrestler, the rare times that happens, my brain automatically goes, you have a terrible memory. You're going to forget everything you know about wrestling as soon as you walk out the curtain. And I know myself, I would. So I'd go out and go, yeah. Oh, what am I doing here? Oh, this is a bad idea.
I think that's everyone's fear, though. I think that's everyone's fear. Like, I know that's going to be like one of my biggest fears of when we do finally get to do that show, and we do finally get to, like, you know, debut each and every one of us. I think, for me anyway, it's going to be a case of, okay, just don't mess this up. You're going to get through that curtain, and you're going to smash this. You're going to get there. And as soon as I walk through that curtain, I know for a fact there's going to be a little, you know, 7 to 10-year-old boy just shout and call me fat or something like that, and that's going to totally throw me the rest of the way. I'll be a face. I'll be booked as a face, and I just know for a fact I'm going to turn that little boy for whatever reason. It's like, oh, I'll just go heel. No, I'll be face to everyone else, but it's heel to him the whole night because of that.
Yeah, if I've learned anything from going to shows, kids are the most brutal of critics, because they judge you as soon as you go out that curtain. If you're bigger, they'll go, well, you better be a good guy, because otherwise I'm going to call you fat the whole night.
they're just brutally honest. That is, kids have no filter. Yeah, that's what makes them brilliant, I think.
I did a show my very brief wrestling career. I just did speaking, and I went out, and this is pretty much, I looked like this, but I was wearing a shirt and tie, a clip-on tie, which I lost very much every time I went into the ring. It was gone. But as soon as I went out that curtain and I scowled at someone, I was balding the whole night. Didn't matter what I did. Didn't matter what I said. I was baldy, and I don't think anyone learnt my name. So it was, yeah, it's kids, just brutal. So I did have a train of thought. There's one last kind of wrestling question, and it's from Omar Muhammad, and it says, when are you going to grow out the diesel power mullet?
Okay.
I feel like there's a story behind this.
There is. Me and Omar have this, because Omar's obviously trained with us at FPWA. He's really talented, a really cool guy, really nice guy. Probably one of the nicest there, to be honest. He won't like me saying that. But we kind of have this like little running joke that we're like the Diesel and Shawn Michaels of FPWA. I don't know how it came, but okay, maybe that's going a bit far. We're just Diesel and Shawn Michaels. Like, eventually I'm going to come out and be as heavy, like, be his bodyguard, and it's going to be that Diesel Shawn Michaels aesthetic to it. And I think that's why he wants me to go with the mullet, which, you know, I'm all for, but to be honest, that's not something the family want me doing. It's not something the girlfriend wants me doing. So, I mean, I'm all for doing it, like, but it's going to take some convincing, I think.
Every so often you'll come by with just one leather glove going, yeah, come on.
Come on. I'm tempted, don't get me wrong. No, it is something that, you know, we briefly discussed, but who knows what will happen. I want it to happen, and, you know, let's start a hashtag for it, you know, get a team together for it.
Speaking of tag teams, when all this lockdown started, we did the tournaments, the mega tournaments of Doom, the tag team, whatever I called it, Battle Bowl, that's what I called it. We had a tag team by the name of the Chaotic Connection.
I wonder who that was.
Which was yourself and Joe T. Nova, who...
Oh, yeah.
FPWA as well. So,
yes.
You did promos, which was very kind of you.
I'm disappointed in that, by the way. Disappointed in that, because I think me and... who else did promo? I think Johnny Reeves did one from FWA as well. I'm pretty sure he put one out as well. But, like, I didn't see a lot of promos coming that way, and I thought that was going to be, like, a big part of it, which...
I hope so as well. I mean, Brent Carter, of course, as part of the Scrandalorians, they put out some stuff, which was wild. Emily Hayden got Toasty involved. So, I mean, there was stuff about, but yeah, it was just a bit odd. But I wasn't expecting anything. It was just a fun joke that I had, and it suddenly spun into graphics and people taking it very seriously.
Oh, yeah, like...
when the guys from Aberdeen started taking over matches.
Oh, don't.
Folk were just getting furious.
I remember a Twitter exchange between me and Vago, and that was fun. I couldn't tell if he was joking or not, put it that way, and I would like to get some clarity on that eventually, because like I have helped out at a WrestleZone show before and I've met him, but now I feel like if I go back and help out, then I'm just going to get leathered. I'm like, okay. But yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, Vago's already drawing the ire of Brent Carter with pointing out that he's the heavy metal hooligan, and I think we'll have to get Mickey Vago on at some point. At least I can ask him if any of the FPWA guys come up, it's all right. It's all cool.
So cool. I mean, to be fair, I mean, you've got me and Joe T. Nova. We'll gladly just have a match now, because believe it or not, see when that was drawn and you pulled both our names out and we got put together as a tag team, like, we were just thinking to ourselves beforehand, oh yeah, this will be quite a good opportunity to, like, you know, network, we'll get to meet, like, you know, or get to chat to some of the guys in the industry, more experience, we can learn, we can maybe make a few contacts that way, and then you slap us two together and we're like, oh okay, so this is we're getting put out in the first round, this will be great. But it was weird, because we then eventually started talking, and you know what, if like this does well or whatever, or this, I wouldn't actually mind being a tag team. Like Joey said that to me, and I went, yeah, that's fine. I would actually love to be a tag team as well, son. I think we can possibly be good at. So you managed to create a tag team. You probably created several tag teams from that tournament, to be honest, but you managed to create a tag team. I'm not sure if we're sticking with the Chaotic Connection as a full name. I like it, and I think Joe likes it too. So, but yeah, so you created a tag team.
Yeah, that was the thing. I think Rain and Colton Davis as well, they're still like tweeting back and forth, and I'm just like, yeah, I'd said no expectations when I started that. I was just amazed people wanted to take part, and then everyone had a lot of fun, especially when it came to managers. That seemed to be everyone's kind of reason for being involved. Until I had to, well, it's Mickey Vago again. He's getting lots of mentions in this one, who just ruined it by having everyone. Yeah. So I had to impose rules. So I didn't want to, but I had to make rules just for Adam's sanity.
I know. I was going to say something there, was it? Oh, yeah. What I was really surprised at was just, like I said before, me and Joe thought to ourselves, that's it. We're done. We're going to get one mention here. First round, we're out. And then we got to, like, the semi-finals, which we weren't expecting whatsoever. And by that point, we're just thinking, oh, okay, let's win this. Come on, we're going to win this. And we were just really annoyed that it was one vote that put us out, and we still remember that. That's our little, like, we're clutching onto that as like a you know, like our claim to fame almost.
The semi-final of the Battle Bowl, the SWM, yes. Battle Bowl. So you did WrestleZone in Montrose, wasn't it? You did the setup for. So what was it like? Because at that point we've only seen WCL, FPWA. What was it like being backstage in that environment in a totally family-friendly show like WrestleZone?
Oh, it was good. I'm going to say weird just because I'd never actually like been to a live show before. Worked behind a live show before. I've set up rings before, obviously. I've done all that, but it was like in that live show capacity. We got there quite early, actually. We got there about an hour earlier than we were supposed to, so we tripped to Subway. That was fun. When the WrestleZone crew arrived, it was a case of get everything inside, like the ring, the merch, the lighting, the sound system, all that. Set everything up. We mainly just helped with the ring, just because that's the heaviest and probably the most complicated to set up. Did all that, helped set up all the chairs, and then, yeah. I think a lot of us were hoping for a better ring time, to be honest, just because, you know, we were training twice a week at that point, and you know, we were really enjoying it. A lot of us that were going there were just wanting more and more ring time as we can, because you know, when you first start out, you just want to keep getting better. Then again, ring time, which was totally fine, short schedule, it was fine. Got there, show was really good. I'd never actually been to a WrestleZone show before at that point, so I never like got to experience like the live kind of. Their live action, obviously. Really good show. it was a bit weird, like, being a runner. I'd never been a runner before, so it was obviously just helping, like, take things backstage when needed, if, like, you know, wrestlers came up with their gear or whatever, like, luring entrance anyway. And then afterwards it was, you know, stripped down, getting into the van again and head home. Got home about 1 a.m. That was great.
So that experience as well, of course, would mean, I suppose right now you would kill for that. But that experience of seeing these, how other shows work, would also be great. So is that set up through, of course, Andy Wilde would have been wrestling on that show, and possibly through Johnny Lyons, who I think would have, well, he would have retired at that point. So what was it like working, what's it like working with Andy?
I've never actually worked. You mean in training? You mean
that? In training. Sorry. Yeah.
Oh, in training. Yeah. That's really, really informative, if I'm completely honest. I'm not just saying that because, you know, he's my trainer and I go to FPWA. Like, he is probably the best trainer I've had in anything I've done. Not just in wrestling, like in like that 2 weeks of MMA that I did and broke my knee. He's really informative. He takes the time. He, like, takes into account your, like, abilities and your, I don't want to say disabilities. I want to say your disadvantages. For example, like, when I first went there, I was completely honest. Like, look, I've just came out of surgery about a few months ago, bad knee, and he does take that into account. Like, he doesn't, like, let me off easy. Like, if we're doing, like, a extreme workout, like, you know, if we're doing burpees, for example, he might say to me instead, okay, don't do that. You can do, for their 10 burpees, you do, like, you know, 20 press-ups or something like that. Just keep the body moving. It's not like he just says, like, Craig, take a seat there now. It's a case of he'll just find something else for me to do. He, like, really adapts to me as well. He's tough but fair, I'd say, which I think everyone should be. And, yeah. And again, I'm not just saying that because I go to FPW and he's the trainer there. I'm saying that because it's true.
I always get the impression when I ever speak to Andy, or if I see his kind of stuff on the FPWA Facebook page, he's one of those guys that won't expect you to do anything that he wouldn't do. So if he tells you to do 10 burpees, he'll be there going, I'm going to do them as well with you.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of thing. So he's very much a lead by example, not just sitting in the corner going, run ropes.
Yeah, no, and he does do it with us. That's the thing. We do this horrific one. It's like a card workout, which is just a full deck of cards, and he'll write down on the whiteboard hearts, like any card that has a heart on it. You do sit-ups and however many numbers, like whatever numbers on it, that's how many you do. So like you five hearts, you do five sit-ups. Or if it's like a jack, a king, or a queen, or an ace, then you do 10, which is, you know, absolutely lovely because there's a bunch of them in the deck. We don't like that, but yeah, and he'll do them all with us, and he will he will say to us like, "Oh, this is absolutely horrible, guys, but come on, we can do it." And it is like motivational. It's just saying like, "Okay, this guy's not just. It's not like he's just, you know, taking our money and telling us to do stuff. He's actually keep doing it with us and showing us what to do at the same time, and not just for the warm up for." Every move that we do, and I've got to say we do get quite, I'm going to say, spoiled, because there's stuff like at training that we'll see him do that I've not seen him do in the ring in a little bit, like a long time, I'd say. So you know, we get treated to that.
So I think that's enough wrestling chat just for the moment. We're going to go back to some more random questions. Grant Carter, who was last week's, well, he wasn't, his pro athlete. Wait, it was our guest 2 weeks ago. You can also listen to that interview on YouTube and everywhere to everyone who's watching. How many McNuggets is too many McNuggets? Again, is this an insider joke that we don't know?
No, this is the first of me hearing it. And, like, the answer is you can never have too many McNuggets. Like,
that was my thought, yeah.
Like, come on, Brent, come on, pal. Like, I can be going to training, but when we get back there, I might have to smack you for that comment, that question. Jeez, oh.
I mean, I think I read online somewhere that if you have like 100 of them, you're not going to have a good time. But if you have 100 of anything, then of course you're not. A good time.
Exactly. Like, I mean, fair enough. Like, you've seen, if you've seen like Super Size Me, that documentary, then yeah, fair enough. But just let me eat what I eat, you know. Like, just let me be happy. Come on.
That's my tradition. Well, if we go to, if I take my wife to the wrestling, I say take, drag. When I drag my wife to the wrestling, for WrestleZone, the tradition is we either go for a Pizza Hut beforehand, mainly because that gets her happy to go to the wrestling, or we have to get McNuggets on the way home. Sometimes both. Most often.
Say, why not both?
Well, usually, because insider tip here, we have our pizza, but we keep half of the the crust, the cheese crust, and when we get home, a bit of garlic mayo, dip.
Ooh.
That's a wee post-wrestling treat.
Andy's is going to be listening to this and me and Craig, I'm so disappointed. Like, do not do that, Craig. I'm like, okay.
I think for her, it's like, I've earned this. I've watched you just ignore me for 3 hours. I have earned this cheesy crust with garlic mayo. Another of the most random questions before I delve into things I want to know about anime and D&D. Kevin Williams, which from this point forward is just going to be a staple question. So Kevin, you don't need to ask me to ask this anymore. Favourite dinosaur?
Barney.
Just straight up Barney. The purple dinosaur.
Barney is a dinosaur from our imagination. He's great.
Do you have a second favourite dinosaur? Or is it just Barney?
And Archaeopteryx.
All right. I have no idea what that is. Okay. So what's that from?
I seen the question and I thought, I need, like, Barney's obviously answered. This is the first thing that popped in my head was Barney. And then I thought, okay, no, I need a serious answer. And Archaeopteryx was the first thing that came to my head. And I want to say that they're like the ones that are about the height of us, maybe. But they're not raptors, I know that much.
Have they been in a Jurassic Park film?
Probably. They're probably in the background somewhere, to be honest.
Okay, that's fine. For anyone who wants to check that out, do it. Right, okay, so the dinosaur question has been and gone. So if we can just move on now. Dungeons & Dragons, I know nothing about it, other than anything that I've seen on Community, any TV sitcom, or I watched that film, Dungeons & Dragons, which didn't really make me want to know more. How did you get into it?
I got into it when I was at uni, actually. So I went to university in Sunderland, the University of Sunderland. And I was studying broadcast media production, BA honours, and mainly in radio, mainly. I did a bit of TV. Well, no, I didn't, actually. I did a bit of journalism, that's what it was. But I did TV stuff in the journalism part of it. Anyway. So they obviously have their like student-led clubs and all that, university, like your sports teams and all that. But me being me and just wanting to be lazy for my entire university run was just a case of, I'm going to try something different. And I'd heard about Dungeons & Dragons, and it always seemed like a fun game and something I wanted to try because I felt that I was very creative. Like, I did a lot of drama in my high school years, and I just kind of thought, that sounds fun. Dungeons & Dragons, pen and paper. Fair enough, I may not like the writing, but I can roll dice and I can pretend to kill things, so that sounds fun. So I went along, and the first D&D game I actually played wasn't even D&D. It was basically, it was the Star Wars role-playing game, which the Wizards of the Coast that run D&D did release years and years ago. It's owned by someone else now, I think. I can't honestly remember. But the first D&D kind of game I played was a Star Wars one, and it was a Sith campaign. I don't know this might be a silly question. Have you ever seen Star Wars? I know that you've seen, I think from the last podcast I heard with Brent, you said that you'd seen maybe the original trilogy and the prequels.
Yes, and yeah, Revenge of the Sith kind of killed any joy I had for Star Wars. Attack of the Clones did. Revenge of the Sith kind of just went, this is okay, but no, it's not. So I prepared to get a lot of hate from people that are big Star Wars fans. That's a lie. I did watch Force Awakens. I'll recount that from last week. I did watch Force Awakens, but that's about as far as I've got.
That's fair. But yeah, so this game I played was basically just a Star Wars D&D game, but it wasn't D&D. It had its own system, its own rules, which I only played the one game of, so I can't actually remember most of them. I just know that in this story, this game we were playing, we were going to a Sith Academy, which it was set way, way, way back before like the prequels or anything like that. So like if you ever played the Knights of the Old Republic video games or anything like that from Star Wars, then you might know what I'm talking about. So we kind of set back then, and that was that. I can't remember too much about it. But then the second game I played was actual D&D, and that's where things kind of got weird, because I've got the books and all that, but it's a lot of reading, and each book, the main core books anyway. If you want to like play Dungeons and Dragons, I always suggest going on to the D&D Beyond website, or just, you know, the D&D website, and just learning as much as you can on the website for free before purchasing like a PDF or the actual book. The book itself that I bought, which you can buy from like, you know, a Waterstones or any kind of online bookstore really, you can buy it, but it's going to cost you like £40 just for the book. And that has everything you need in it, though. It has, you know, the races, the rules, the classes you can play, the spells that aren't in the expansion books or packs. It even comes with like a D&D character sheet in the back, which, you know, sticks in the back. However, you can go onto the D&D website and download PDFs of D&D character sheets for free and then print them off. There's a tip for you guys. So you don't have to buy character sheets from like comic book stores or something like that. Or you can just do either and grab an A4 sheet of paper and then just trace a copy from a picture you've seen online. That works as well. Yeah, it's a very complicated game, I would say, but once you know it, it's easy, if that makes sense. So a lot of math is involved, which can be off-putting, but it's simple math or maths. I'm not American. I must remember that. But yeah.
Do you have a character name? Do you have your character that you use?
I have multiple characters. I'm actually a player and a DM, or a dungeon master, as they get called, or a game master sometimes. The main one that I usually play as a character called Greywall, which is a wizard who just does whatever he wants to do, really. I've used him as both a player and a DM, and the player game that I've played as him, he is just he tries to be like the mom or the dad of the group, but he's ultimately just a baby. He's just the character that, you know, will try to act like, you know, adult, but then, you know, somebody will look at him funny and they'll go, fireball, you know, like kind of like screw you kind of thing. But as when I'm DMing, if I'm running the game, if I'm writing the story and I'm, you know, running the game for the players, there's always a recurring theme in my games where he is the one constant character, where I have made him somewhat of a godlike being who can travel through dimensions, which is the only way I could the only way that I could justify him being in so many worlds at once, because my players don't take kindly to my, I want to say a word, but you've told me I'm not to swear, so.
to your BS for just going, yes, he's here.
There we go. Okay, him again, clear guys? Cool. I currently run a few games now. I've got a few people, a few of my work buddies that want me to run a game for them, and I'm telling them I can't right now because of lockdown, but still. I don't know, is there anything else you want to know about D&D?
I think I've learned a little bit there. The only thing kept popping into my head is I recently finished Community. I don't know if you've seen Community.
I've heard of it. I've not got a chance to watch it yet.
Well, they run a couple times in the run, they run a D&D game, which is pretty much, like I said, one of my only experiences of what Dungeons & Dragons is. And there's a recurring character called Hector the Well-Endowed. And it just pops into my head. And any time when I saw your profile, I said Dungeon Master, I was like, Hector the Well Endowed. And it just forever pops into my head. Other thing he was talking about is radio as well. So this is something that we kind of have in common, as in I did hospital radio for a bit, which didn't really go well because I kept forgetting which songs we shouldn't be playing. There was a list of inappropriate songs to play in a hospital. And
they're the best songs you play.
You give me a list of songs I can't play. It's the only songs I could think of to play. So things like Tiny Tempa's Pass Out was inappropriate. And it was just, as soon as I saw the list, I was like, well, I think of no other songs now. That is the songs I want to play. So I'm assuming you did something a bit more substantial than playing Let's Get Ready to Rumble to people possibly on their deathbeds. So what was your experience doing radio broadcasting, and what was it like?
Yeah. So I started radio when I was like 14, doing community stuff. I didn't just walk into like BBC and say, I'm doing this now. No, I started off in community radio, a place called Kinglase. There was a station there called K-Town FM, which was run by Fife College at the time. And I just went along because my uncle was doing the same kind of course that I would eventually go on and do. And she just said, you can come along, you can be my co-host, that'd be awesome. I'm like, aye, maybe, no problem, I'll do that. And then about a month later, he left and I got left the show. And I was like, oh, okay, this is new. So I had to quickly learn just what to do, what to say, how to put a link together, how to line up your next song, what to talk about, what not to talk about, everything like that. And which would eventually lead to me saying, you know what, I could probably make a career out of this. And I decided to enroll in Fife College, which we would then start doing the Fife College radio. We would do a few things there. I then got the opportunity to go and work with Kingdom FM while at college, which is Fife's number one radio station, East Lothian, really, I think. That was fun. I never got to go on the air with them like all the time. I never got to host a show, for example. If I was ever on the air with them, it would be to, provide like a commentary on maybe something they're talking about, or if I'm answering a question, if they need like somebody to come on. But if I was ever working with them, it would always be like at live events, or if they were needing some like stuff done out and about, we work with them. When I got down to Sunderland, that's when it kind of started to like take off a little bit more. So while I was doing university there, studying for my BA honours, I joined up with Spark FM, the radio station that was led by the students of the university, which was an award-winning radio station. Now, I started doing that. I just kind of walked in and said, hi, I'm new here, need to do a show, anything you can do. They asked me what I liked, and I said a bunch of stuff. I said wrestling, I said rock, I said pretty much anything I could really to get me on a show. They put me on a show called Takedown, which was their staple rock and heavy metal and punk kind of show, which was really fun to be a part of. I got to host it a few times, which was great. I was usually just there to, review songs and be another voice on the air. I then met a guy who has done quite well for himself, actually, in the radio community. He's currently does a thing for Sunderland and for Rocker Report, which is the Sunderland FC fan kind of podcast kind of thing that they do, which is quite good. But me and him, a guy called Johnny Goldsmith, ended up doing a show called Rope Break, which was the wrestling chat show of Spark FM, which managed to, I'm not exactly sure what episode it was, but I remember it being an episode where we had just like four of us in the studio just laughing and just not taking the show very seriously. Reviewed Raw, reviewed SmackDown, reviewed pretty much anything we could, and just started laying into like all the wrestling tropes. We managed to get to the number five spot on the sports chart, I'm pretty sure, I want to say SoundCloud, because it wasn't MixCloud, it was SoundCloud, I think, which for a long time I was like, oh, well, might actually be good at this. I ended up then being nominated for the Olive Stream Radio Awards, which I didn't win, but I got nominated for Volunteer of the Year. That was fun. And then afterwards, after all that, I decided to try my hand at doing my own show from the ground, from the, you know, build up from the ground up, and that was an anime talk show, which I thought, this seems like a city that's going to be full of, like, you know, anime fans and weebs and all that, but yeah, it was half and half. It did well, I think. It just, you know, never got to where I wanted it to be. That was a show called Hadouken, and that was fun. I then moved back to Scotland, radio wise, and it's just been kind of here. I've always wanted to express my interest in like doing commentary for wrestling and all that. I've tried a few times to, like, you know, mess people. I remember when FCW were starting up, obviously, and they actually put out a thing saying like, oh, you know, we're looking for commentators, anyone experienced in this kind of field, and I sent my application in. I never heard anything back, and I was like, oh, I even sent them a demo and everything, and I'm like, oh, okay, cool. This was when I was training at FPWA as well, and it was, you know, I just never heard back, but, you know, that's fine. You, this kind of thing you expect. Other than that, though, it's been kind of, you know, stale.
So, you mentioned anime. I don't want to, just because we've been talking for a little bit, I don't want to keep you whole evening. Top five favorite animes. What would your list be?
Oh, you have to ask that question. Okay, so top five would probably have to be in no particular order. Number one spot would be probably be like the Dragon Ball franchise, just because I'm a massive Shonen fan and Dragon Ball is just great. Dragon Ball, Dragon Ball Z, we don't talk about Dragon Ball GT, and in Dragon Ball Super. Like, you know, like the three, Dragon Ball Z, Dragon Ball, and Dragon Ball Super are just amazing, in my opinion. No one can tell me any different. And then the rest, it kind of goes like, you know, My Hero Academia, Naruto, One Punch Man. I just like that. It's pretty funny. And Fairy Tail as well.
Okay, so I'm learning a lot. At some point, this is going to end up just being a dinosaur and anime podcast, judging by the conversations we've had. If it works, if it gets me the views, then why not?
Exactly.
So we've got our segment that you were fearing.
Yeah,
from last week, we started the 10 count, and I have a list. I've written it down. So it's very easy. I've pretty much picked out names from past interviews you've done with us, which anyone can check out on the SWN website, swnscotland.wordpress.com. Go to interviews, and then we've got a nine count with you, which is nine basic questions. And also, Westy did a more in-depth interview with you as well, which if you want to know more about wrestling, that's probably a better place to go than this podcast. But We still spoke about wrestling.
Probably the best place, yeah.
So, number one, FPWA. So, hang on. I haven't actually told you the rules. It's word association. Word association. I've given you time to think about that one. Number one, FPWA.
Amazing.
Number two, Edge.
Rated R.
Number three, Andy Wilde.
Inspirational.
Number four, Rey Mysterio.
Great.
Number five, this is on depth. Number five, Undertaker.
Scary.
Six, The Chaotic Connection.
Greatest tag team to not debut yet.
Seven, Ross Hunter.
Gonna be great. Talented. There you go.
Eight, Johnny Reeves.
Going to get battered when we get back to FPWA, probably.
Nine, Crimson Cobra.
Scary. Sorry, terrifying. There we go.
Terrifying. Number 10, last one, greatest of all time.
Me. No. I want to change that one.
No. Lock it in, answering.
No. Oh, you're locking that in? Okay. Great.
Who would be the greatest of all time? She was Jericho, is it?
Yeah, Jericho, definitely. Greatest of all time, Jericho.
Cool. Right, so I've got one more question and we'll do your social medias and that. So how did you come about with the Crimson Cobra name?
Yeah, so that came about when I was just with my friends, just trying to come up with ideas, because originally I was going to go with the name Jack Henry, which I kind of thought to myself, that'll work. But then somebody pointed out to me that sounds an awful lot like Joe Hendry's name. And I'm like, oh, okay, maybe not then. Thanks for that, you know. I thought it was a really cool name. And that's funny because it's my two middle names, so I thought, oh, I might get away with that. But then I just said, you know what, we'll just go with my real name and then we'll come up with a cool nickname. And we'll just kind of spitballing ideas, like something that would, like, you know, be kind of cool and kind of fearing. And then I just came up with, like, my friends suggested that, oh, maybe go with something like, you know, something like a snake, because they're, you know, pretty, you know, devious and all that. And then I just kind of thought to myself, well, what about the Crimson Cobra? That was the first thing that kind of popped in my head, because double C, and it kind of made sense. And then I got told, yeah, that's it, keep that. You need to keep that now. So, because of my friend, I'm getting called the Crimson Cobra.
I mean, there's worse names you could have come up with. It could have went, you could be Craig Straw. Barry. So there could have been a lot of results.
Don't get me wrong, I thought of like a gimmick like that as well, just with the name, and, you know, I just changed my gear colour, and depending on the gear colour, that would be the berry I was that night. So
that would actually be amazing. You would run into problems probably.
Don't, because I'm thinking about it.
You probably run into problems.
Oh yeah, that one definitely.
Yeah, you know the one. So yeah, so yeah. Blueberry.
I know the one you're
strawberry. Yeah, there would be a definite problem. Okay, so I think that's a good way to round off. Where can people find you on social media?
So you can find me on Facebook at Craig Berry Wrestler. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Craig Berry 101. And that's pretty much all my socials.
Cool. So if it's not, I'm sure I'll tag them in somewhere. But thank you for joining us for this episode of the SWM podcast. It's been a very educational time for me.
Yeah, thanks for having me. And if you ever need another guest or even a co-host for like any podcast you're going to do, then I've got the experience. Just, you know, give me something to do in lockdown, please.
Well, I have been just going on Twitter, was it capitulating, I think that's the word, speaking about doing another podcast, but I kind of want to just try to at least do one of these interviews a week without it going totally wrong, as we have to pray for, hashtag pray for laptop every time I start one of these. I've already had the internet pop up going, internet is unstable twice, and I'm like, oh God, no, not again.
Oh yeah.
But I'll bear that in mind. We could be, I can't think of a cool Strachan Berry combination. Could just call it the BS podcast, but we'll come back to that.
Could be, yeah.
Excellent. But thank you for joining me.